In this video, I'll be exploring the multimedia capabilities of Windows 3.1. Around 94, there was a big buzz about multimedia. It was a primary driver for ordinary people to buy a new computer here in Sweden. Which is fun because, like with all new trends, nobody was quite sure what multimedia was. It was the capability all new computers should have, and a lot of multimedia software was being developed. Microsoft developed the Multimedia PC standard, which was a set of specifications a multimedia PC must meet. But not only that, Microsoft also published a number of multimedia applications and games for Windows 3. Aside from fast graphics and sound, a multimedia PC should also have a CD-ROM drive, which was another exciting technology in the computer space. CD-ROM quickly became a household word, borrowed into the language with the usual whining. Doubly so here in Sweden, since it also means rum, the alcohol, as well as a few other meanings, of which one was joked about on occasion. Anyway, while multimedia was mostly about entertainment, there were some non-game titles making use of these multimedia features. Aside from making boring office applications more obnoxious, there were also so-called multimedia encyclopedias, which were essentially the information of an ordinary paper encyclopedia, with search features and multimedia features like sound and video clips added. There were a number of vendors of these, but the one featured the most in the magazines I looked at were Microsoft Encarta, were called Modest Review Scores. The 94 edition was a lot more popular than the initial 93 release, as it was priced more like a regular multimedia title, and not the several hundred dollars like a paper encyclopedia would cost. Well, it's an encyclopedia. You can search for a topic and read about stuff. You can also copy portions into your own documents, and when you're printing stuff, it likes to remind you about copyright laws. It also includes audio and video clips, but my Mitsumi drive was just having none of that. On the theme of multimedia applications that aren't games, I do have this multimedia guide to the World Wide Web. It's supposed to give you an idea of what you can find on the web. What makes it multimedia is this narrative voice droning on in the background.
Här följer tre sidor med några av de hetaste www-sidorna på internet.
But I'll spare you from hearing that one. If you got out onto the web early on, you might recognize some of these sites. Apparently, you can use the web to read about them fancy Silicon Graphics workstations. Or access a travel guide for Paris. Maybe I should look into that internet thing at some point. This next thing isn't really multimedia, but I don't know where else to shoehorn it in. On this same disk, I get my first experience with Adobe Acrobat Reader and PDFs. It might not always feel like it today, but back in 94, PDF was an actual solution to a real problem. Unless you knew the recipient and what software they had, it was basically impossible to send digital documents more complicated than plain text files. The most compatible way to send your document from one PC to another was to fax it. This is where PDF comes in, as it allows for text and pictures to be combined with actual formatting. Previously, we had been limping along with PostScript files, but PDF took that PostScript standard and made it more portable between different platforms. PostScript files could be real troublesome if you didn't have the right fonts installed and such. This specific PDF file I'm looking at is a product guide based on the reviews this magazine has done over the year. There was a bit of talk at the time of the possibility to release magazines and newspapers digitally as PDFs, but the format wasn't quite ready for it. Anyway, to start up with the games, let's have a look at the Microsoft Best of Entertainment pack. This was a selection of games from the previous Ford Entertainment packs, released between 1990 and 1992, with the compilation itself being released in 1994. They are fairly simple graphically, with only a few using sound at all, which reflects the kind of games you'd see in Windows previously. Like Rodent's Revenge, where your goal is simply to turn cats into cheese. Or Pipe Dream, where your task is to build a sufficiently long path for the green ooze from a random assortment of pipe bits. Or Ski Free, which actually have a bit of moving graphics. Whereas in Jazz Ball, we get a few sound effects too. One of the bigger games as such is Chip's Challenge, with sound effects, music and a whole bunch of levels. This is beyond a simple puzzle game, this has content. It's still a puzzle game though, in each level the goal is to collect all the chips and make it to the exit. In general, there really wasn't that many games released on Windows before 1994, as the graphics performance in Windows on most consumer hardware was underwhelming to say the least. And the games released tended to be quite simple. The Entertainment Pack was pretty much the level most games stuck to. During 1994, this started to change, but MS-DOS would remain as the primary platform for games for a few more years. Since basically nobody else were releasing games on Windows at this time, here's another one Microsoft brought us, Microsoft Golf for Windows. This is basically a version of Lynx 386 for Windows. Normally, I wouldn't even bother talking about something as dull as this. If it wasn't for the fact that our then Prime Minister, Carl Bildt, called it a defeat for humanity upon seeing it at a trade show. Personally, I'm all for computer golf, if that means we can repurpose golf courses for better things. Like nature reserves, solar panel farms, and mini golf. Fun fact about this game, it's actually a 32-bit application. It's built on Microsoft's Win32s framework, which brings a selection of 32-bit APIs from WinNT to Windows 3. Win32s was a bit of a testbed for Microsoft with the funking technology, which allowed 32-bit applications to use 16-bit APIs. Going the other way, allowing 16-bit applications to use 32-bit APIs, would be a critically important feature of Windows 95. Not only did it need to work, the performance overhead needed to be as small as possible, as Microsoft anticipated a lot of users to keep some 16-bit applications when upgrading their underpowered computers to Windows 95. One downside of 32-bit applications compared to 16-bit ones are that they tend to use a bit more memory.
I hate it when I do that.
After an embarrassing number of tries, I finally get my golf clap. And for those wondering, this is what the lady character looks like.
That'll play.
So, what about games for Windows that weren't published by Microsoft? There were a few of them actually. But most of them were edutainment titles, with the others mostly being ports from MS-DOS. There were a few odd Windows originals, but tracking down one of these with somewhat interesting graphics and finding an original 94 release was harder than I thought. So we'll be having a look at D-Generation, which is a Windows port of a 1991 MS-DOS game. It's entirely keyboard driven and doesn't really take advantage of the Windows environment, but it's technically a game for Windows. Next, let's have a look at something a bit more demanding. The 93 hit on Macintosh, released for PC 94, Myst. I've seen modern references claiming that Myst needs a double-speed CD-ROM drive, but the manual with this copy doesn't say that, so I'm giving it a go. Myst also marks the start of a trend, where Windows is used as a platform not for its performance, but in order to simplify the game development. While the original Macintosh version of Myst was made in HyperCard, the Windows version seems to be made in something else. We'd later see games coming out based on other simple multimedia platforms, like Macromedia Director. Moving on, in an effort to increase the graphics performance on Windows, Microsoft released the WinG API for Windows 3 in September 94. This was part of a larger push for better multimedia performance on the Windows, which would culminate with the launch of DirectX in 95, internally known as the Manhattan Project. But that's for a later video. There weren't a whole lot of games making use of WinG, especially not in 94, and tracking down an original release for 94 isn't always easy. I did find this shareware copy of Nightmare 3D, so let's have a look at it. On first startup, we get this screen where it's tuning itself to my specific computer. This too was first released for MS-DOS and later ported to Windows. Its graphical complexity is somewhere between Wolfenstein and Doom, and I guess it runs alright. Aside from games, one of the hottest applications for the CD-ROM technology was adult entertainment. At Comdex 94, which was one of the largest computer trade shows in the world, the multimedia section was basically nothing but smut. In many instances, you could also get your copies signed, and the booths would draw large crowds. Contents range from large collections of static pictures, to interactive fiction, to low-resolution renditions of gas station VHS rentals in QuickTime format. According to this article, most of the discs weren't that indecent, and if equivalent movies were shown in a theater, they would have been 15 years and up or so. Given the poor selection available here, about a couple dozen or so titles available from importers, I imagine it was more of a niche curiosity here. Most of it was of low quality, but that's not something we're gonna explore on this channel. Is what I was going to say. But now I'm curious, how bad was it really? Most of the titles I found advertised hasn't been archived, but I did find a few editions of Penthouse Virtual Photoshoot. According to the README, it should work on a 386 with a single-speed CD-ROM drive. This one's definitely 18 years and up, but hopefully there's at least a couple scenes we can look at before they start taking their clothes off. That intro seems a bit slow. Yeah, that's not great.
Come on, why don't you try it?
And there goes the Mitsumi. I wonder how much of that was the C-Drone Drive's fault. There's this video file with a weird name on the disc, so I'll copy it to my hard disk and play from there, with the included player. It's not great in full screen. But I guess it counts as a video with window. If you saw the 93 episode where I installed my C-Drone Drive, you'll know that I had acceptable FMV performance in the 7th guest. So I guess that just goes to show what a performance gap there could be between DOS and Windows at this time. But with such poor performance on the stupid Mitsumi drive, I guess we can conclude that my 386 isn't exactly a multimedia powerhouse. But we already knew that. Check back next week when I'll try my luck with Debian Linux. Until then, thank you for watching.